Talking about the doctrine of the church today, which is called ecclesiology, like Pastor Luke has said, ecclesiology. So we want to uncover or unearth this term and see what it has to do with us. The study of the church, is here to ecclesiology, it basically means the study of the church. And in general, it addresses various issues, which is biblical definition of the church and its function. Other issues involved in this ecclesiology include forms of church government, which is basically how to run a church, the eldership and all that, leadership offices, ordinances, which he talked about, the sacraments and all that, worship, and the relationship between the New Testament church and Israel, the Old Testament people of God. The term church has been used differently. It has multiple usages. Hata nikisema church sahi, you know we can give ukisikia church, what do you think about? When I say church, if I ask you what is a church? Acha niulize hawa walimu wangu. Florence, what is a church? Before you read the slide. She said she can be the church, a person of people. It can refer to the building, AIC Milimani, okay? Exactly. It sometimes is used to describe a building or some other structure. It can refer to a specific group of believers who, for example, attend Africa Inland Church Milimani. So when we come on Sunday, we are a church, AIC Milimani. Even as we fellowship here as the youth, this is a church. It is also used to refer to a denomination, isn't it? Such as Presbyterian Church, Baptist Church, Catholic Church, African Inland Church, and what have you. Okay? And then, nataka tusome leo kidogo, so that at least utatoka hapa na ka Greek kidogo. And today you can graduate. Takama matiangi hata kubali. This can be a theology class. Because it is very good to understand, ecclesiology is not an English word. It is coined from somewhere. It comes from the Greek ekklesia. Okay, ekklesia. I can write it in Greek for you, lakini haina maana kwa sababu itakuwa ngumu. Pastor Luke tu ndiye atani challenge kwa hiyo. So ekklesia, which means assembly in Greek. I continue doing a little bit of etymology there. Etymology means how the word has developed. It is a compound. You know what a compound is? You know this in English. A compound, this means of two words, of the Greek preposition ek, which means out from, and the verb kaleo, this is Greek, which means to call. So when we are talking about ecclesia or the church, this is people who have been called out of, sawa sawa, and we'll be seeing where have they been called out of. And the most generic definition, which is the most, you know, the most original definition by this lexicon, which is a Greek tool which we use, is a gathering of citizens called out from their homes into some public place. Actually, in Acts 19 and those verses we see there, it was not necessarily meaning a calling of people gathered together in a church or in a building. It just described people who are grouped somewhere. So please remember, ek, ukisahau kitu ingine, a church, this is a people who have been called out of, and this will be out of the world, sawa sawa. This is ek, out of, and kaleo, to call. So even you can start saying, unezaita mwiks, you say kaleo, mwiks kaleo, I call you, to show that you have studied some little bit of Greek. We take it back a little bit again to Hebrew, how the word has developed, etymology again. This is a class, eh? This is kind of a theology class. We can give the notes later. The Septuagint. This is the only place where you learn these things unless you go to Bible school. What is the Septuagint? This is a translation of the Hebrew Bible into Greek language. You have seen many translations of the Bible. We have NIV and we have all that. The closest translation to the original, to the way that the Bible was written originally is, of course, the Odd, the King James Version, the original one. Now the Septuagint is the very first translation. You know the Bible was written in Hebrew, isn't it? The Old Testament. So the very first translation of Hebrew into Greek language is called the Septuagint. And it used ecclesia to translate the word which was in Hebrew called halal, meaning a congregation, an assembly, company, or other organized body. So ecclesia in Hebrew was halal, and it was used to define a congregation, an assembly, company, or other organized body. So these Old Testament uses of ecclesia are not necessarily regarded as referring to the New Testament church. For example, the word church does not appear in the King James Version of the Old Testament. So the word has continued to develop, to grow, but in the Old Testament, you may not find ecclesia referring to a church as we have it now. But we move on to the New Testament, which is the dispensation where we are living now, where we can understand the word better, because this is where the word church has been used most. Ecclesia is found most often in the writings of Paul. Who knows some of the writings of Paul? Which books has Paul written?
Galatians.
Galatians? Which other one? Romans? Which other one? Revelation. Senor? Who wrote Revelation?
John.
Okay. Which John?
Disciple.
Okay. So, in the writings of Paul, he uses the term to refer to a group of believers in a specific city. That is why we find in his letters, he addresses them to the church of God in Corinth. So when Paul is writing to the churches, he is referring to a particular group of people, believers, not just people actually, in a specific city. So he says to the church of God in Corinth, you have the passages there, the churches in Galatia, like you said, the church of the Thessalonians. And the New Testament picture of the church is also universal. When we say universal, okay, the church can be a small congregation, but there is one body, Ephesians 4:4, and there are times when the church is used to speak of the entire church, which is the community of all the believers who have been washed and sanctified in Jesus Christ. The people who are saved, wherever they are, we call them the church. And this is the universal terminology. So what's the church then, in summary? If somebody asks you to define what the church is, tell them that the church is the whole body of those who through Christ's death have been savingly reconciled to God and have received new life. So this is the whole body of those who have, through Christ's death, been saved, sawa-sawa, and reconciled. So it is very possible to be in a church, to be in a building like this, but you are not part of the church. Are we together? It is very possible to be AIC Milimani Youth. You go to the building, AIC Milimani Church, but you are not part of the body of Christ. And I will tell you at the end what is going to happen. While universal in nature, because we said it's a community of believers, the church finds expression in local groupings of believers that display the same quality as does the body of Christ as a whole. So we have local groupings, say I see Milimani and all that, but we have said it is the church universal. And so you can go to any Protestant church and fellowship, isn't it? We have somebody from Sitam here. I hope they have come to stay. Why did he come? He is coming to church because it is a community of believers. As long as they have been saved and reconciled. Okay? There are some Bible images or biblical images of the church. And I say here that several metaphors or images have been used to describe the church. And you might have heard of these terminologies, which have been used to describe the church. The church has been referred to as the body of Christ. And so you wonder, how can the church be the body of Christ? Is it a part of a leg or an eye or a nose of the body of Christ? And this refers to those who through baptism, faith, and profession belong to Jesus Christ. Christ is the head of this body, okay? You will hear other terms, the church being referred to as the people of God. You have heard it in 1 Peter 2:9. And this, God has chosen a single people among all the mankind. And this is a great privilege to be called a people of God. I know you will be talking about the doctrine of election. Did you know that you did not choose to be saved? If you were, do not think you are very faithful to God. And it is because you confessed your sins. The Lord elected you before you were born. Before the foundations of the world were created, ndio kuja kuokoka. Very tough doctrine there that we battled with in theology. Kuna watu utaubiria until the end of the world, they will never get saved because they have not been elected. So, we are the people of God. We have been chosen among the nations. What a privilege. And you take yourself for granted. Kuna watu hawataona ufalme wa Mungu, hata ukiwahubiria utoe pofu. They have not been chosen. The people of God. We are also called the bride of Christ. And that picture is very vivid because we are having a wedding very soon of people that we love and belong to us. When that wedding will be going on, look at this picture. Ukiona Olive akiingilia hapo with that white gown, beautifully adorned. She is an image. She is a metaphor of the bride of Christ. The church is the bride of Christ. And also in Revelation 19, 7 to 8. And Jesus says in Revelation there that he is coming for his bride, isn't it? The bride was adorned themselves with pure linen. And you will read what pure linen is. Ready to meet Christ. So the church, the believers, Jesus, when he looks down on us, akituangalia, anatuona kama the bride. So we'll be many brides for Christ against one husband. It is not understandable, isn't it, in human terms. The church is also called the temple of God. And when I say this, I feel like shaking because it is God's dwelling place. And where does God dwell? In a holy place with people who have separated themselves. So this church here, I see Milimani, is the temple of God, is God's dwelling place. God is here right now. Did you know that? You do not see him, but he is here personally. He is all over. His spirit is hovering all over. His holy angels are here. The Lord lives here in this church. But even though the Lord wants to live in us, even though we are his bride, it is painful to see that the church is in turmoil today. Can you tell me why? Is the churches we see today, whether a building or people, do you think we live according to what the Lord expects of us? And we look at the marks of a true church. We can discuss briefly. The church is in turmoil today. What have you seen? What have you heard? Why is this? Is the church in turmoil? Ama church iko sawa? Church like here where people meet, but church also the body of Christ. Is all well? What's happening? We can share. What experiences or what have you heard about what's happening in churches? Maybe not in AIC Milimani. Or what's even happening in AIC Milimani? What are the issues? Too tough question. Josiah, una bahati, I traveled with you. Uki travel na mimi lazima uonge. Yes, there's Josiah. Kuna mkono ingine huko nyuma, I don't know the name. Yeah. Josiah, somebody to give Josiah a mic and my brother back there. I hope akuwa ananisalimia. So he will have to say something. Alinisalimia lakini atasema kitu. Okay. Josiah, what are the issues? How is the church in turmoil today?
So that was off guard.
Yes, what are you doing? Off guard. You will not prepare. So you just be ready anytime. You never know. The bride of Christ, ready anytime.
There's a lot of extortionism happening in the public.
That's extortionism, yes.
A lot of heretical teaching.
Yes. Lifanya the only salvationist one or two. The guy is good, yes. What did you call it? So I have to be careful, yes? Heretical teaching? Yes. Mm-hmm.
And
but you know, heretical teachings? Heretical means false teachings. Heresies.
And confusion, especially about the issues of the gifts of the Holy Spirit.
Gifts of the Holy Spirit. Makofi munambayanga mtu na mnadani. Yes. And my brother who is not seated very far from Chelimo Zaponyuma. Somebody, my brother, yes.
We've Cornelius today, the churches today. One thing, we are flowing with the times instead of teaching about the times. Like, let me give you an example. We all know these are the times where, I've forgotten the exact words, where one scale, I mean, we should be measured by the scale, right? Everything will be measured by the scale. Instead of the church teaching us about the time, how to survive with the time, everybody is about, the world has evolved to be about self-actualization. You see, everybody is after his own self-interest. So when you're alone along that path of self-actualization, you forget that you need people with you. Hence, most of us are lonely. And what does the church do? People are lonely. Couples meeting, single people, CGs of you two couples, whatever. All that thing. That's just an example, by the way, to show you how bad it is. So, the New Testament, which teaches us, it Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it's the gospel, right?
Yeah.
The life that Christ lived. And remember, when he died on the cross, he told us that we are dead to this world. And once we are resurrected, once we resurrect metaphorically, of course, once we resurrect, we are new beings. He set the place for us. And the resurrection is through the baptism. The letters teaching us the challenges the church went through and teaching us more about Christ, right?
Yeah.
And of course, towards the end, teaches us what, how to handle these times, you see. If we do not use these pillars that were given to us, where are we going?
Makofi, sana. Thank you so much, brother. I can even end there, Pastor Luke. Sante. Nikama tu, the guy has finished. Yes, so the church is in turmoil, like Josiah and our brother has told us. We have missed the thing, the main point, why we are called to be a church. Prosperity gospel. How to get richer, how you can be a believer and you walk to church. Why you shouldn't live in trouble and all that. And Josiah has talked about heresies and, so many things. So we ask ourselves, and of course our brother, we have moved away from the main thing, and he has said because we are lonely in church, we have started filling the gaps. Couples, fellowship, youth retreats, they are good, but we are getting to that now, right now. What is the true church? And how can we bring those ingredients which a true church should have? I think the PowerPoint, okay, thank you. So, the first thing, and these ones I got from Billy Graham, very strong points, I just summarized from him. The church belongs to Jesus Christ. Friends, we must realize that it is him who founded the church. He is the cornerstone and the foundation upon which it is built. Ephesians 2:20. The church does not belong to Pastor Luke. AIC Milimani Youth. AIC Milimani Children's Ministry or Women Ministry does not belong to Pastor Rachel. AIC Milimani Church does not belong to Reverend Dr. Matthews Mwalwa. But all to congregations, but to Christ alone. It is his dwelling place on earth through the lives of his followers. So you must remember that the church belongs to Jesus Christ. The church is his own. That is why if I decide to resign today and Pastor Luke, you think next Sunday there will be nobody to preach in church. The ministries will continue. Sunday school will continue. The youth will continue. The church will continue. Because the church does not belong to us. Even though nowadays the treat we are seeing, watu wamesahau hiyo, isn't it? They think the church belongs to them. Na kiboko inawangoja. The second thing, Jesus died for the church. And is Lord over the church. I did not die for the church. No pastor died for the church. He is the head of the body, the church. Colossians 1:18 says that in all things he may have the preeminence. If we were to examine church programs today, and Bomet has hit the head, is it the head on the nail or the nail on the head? would Christ really be preeminent? If we look at the programs of AIC Milimani and AIC Milimani Youth and all the ministries, does Christ have the preeminent? Points to ponder there. The third thing, the church exists for fellowship. When Jesus birthed the church, believers submitted to the teachings of the apostles, isn't it? Four things they did. Apart from joining in fellowship together, they prayed together and shared the Lord's Supper. Actually, you go and read Acts 2:42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. The pillars Bomet is talking about, reading the word, to prayer, to fellowship, and breaking the bread. And actually eating what we are going to do right now, that was breaking the bread. Not necessarily the Holy Communion, which maybe some of us may, because of the regulations of the church, you feel like you cannot do it. Basically, whenever they went to fellowship, they ate. Swallowship, we called it at Scott. Fellowship and swallowship. Eating is part of fellowship. It is one of the four markers of a church. Because when people fellowship together, they share meals together, and of course the Lord's Supper is one of them. For them, this fellowship was a test of heaven on earth. And I ask you today, or say and then ask again, church should be heaven on earth. But some have made it hell on earth. Church should be a place we miss to go, that we yearn, we look forward to go, not to dread to go. And I ask you today, Milimani Youth, do you look forward coming to AIC Milimani, coming to the youth fellowship, coming to all the things that we do here? Because church should be that place that I can't wait to go. The church's message is Jesus Christ crucified, risen, and coming again. Not how to get more richer. That is the message we should be preaching. As people observed their witness for Christ, they shouted, "This have turned the world upside down." Acts 17:6. Is the church today making that kind of impact? Or has it become complacent? Like the church at Laodicea, what my brother is saying, complacency. Whom the Lord rebuked by saying, "You are lukewarm, neither cold nor hot." AIC Milimani Youth, are you complacent? Are you cold? Are you hot? Another mark, the church's mission is to make Jesus Christ known. Not just to be fed, grow fat. What happens when you only receive, and you don't give anything? You stagnate or you become obese. You die. You are just receiving. Making Christ known is not a command exclusively given to preachers. One of the greatest priorities of the church is to mobilize the laity, these normal people, to do the work of proclaiming the gospel, which is you. Not only me and Pastor Luke. It is your responsibility. And he was asking you today, did you talk to anybody? Did you bring anybody to Christ? And one of my moments this week, and I cry. When somebody gives their life to Christ, I fast. After that, I fast. I thank God, because to me, this is the core thing. So I led this lady to Christ in my office. I just wait for them to go, then I close my door and cry. Tears of joy. Amen. This is what we are called to do. Just a small example. Why? God has his people everywhere, isn't it? Siwako kila mahali. Living the word of God is what draws people to Christ. Not only saying it, but brethren, living. You don't preach what? Water and drink wine. So we attract people to the Lord by living his word. We have been fed. We know so much. We know a lot of theology, and we speak a lot of it, but do we live it? Your words are too loud. Is it your actions are too loud? I cannot hear your what? Your words. But instead, we are using clever gimmicks, giving excuses as to why we can't reach people. Oh, unajua watu wa siku hizi, youth wa siku hizi, they are not easy to reach. Oh, you know, we are so busy. Clever gimmicks. We are to be witnesses for him wherever we are, whatever we are doing? Are we going to be that? The church must be prepared to endure persecution. It is not a walk by the park to be the church of God, the body of Christ. We are taught to be prepared to wear the belt of truth, put on the breastplate of righteousness, pull on the boots that will carry the gospel, and take up the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, which represents Christ's entire message. That is Ephesians 6, 10 to 18. And we are to keep in mind that this battle is not ours, but God's. The spiritual warfare is real, friends. Persecution is real. We have to suffer for the gospel. And I was on my James chapter 1 to 3. See how James is encouraging the people to go about persecution. But most of our churches today, we do not want to be persecuted. We want to celebrate all the time. We do not want to suffer for Christ. Only when you are fasting, you are celebrating. How many people? We have been fasting for 21 days. Tuliulizwa the other week. Sita uliza uinue mkono. That is between you and God. How many people have fasted for anything this week? What have you suffered for Christ? Of course, some things come. You let them happen, but other persecutions just come. Are you ready to suffer for Christ? And then the church is the bride of Christ. I love this. It's a mark of a true church. It is also a metaphor. That glorious day is coming when we will be caught up in the air with our bridegroom, Jesus Christ. The bride of Christ is a triumphant and eternal church which will gather to his side and reign with him forever. The angels will sing, instruments will resound, God's people will praise and worship the Redeemer. What a day that will be for the church eternal. The church eternal is the church that will endure to the end, isn't it? Are you going to be part of that church eternal? Are you going to endure to the end? Or when you face persecution and trouble along the way, are you going to give up? And to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. This is the church, the bride of Christ. And I conclude by posing these three questions to you. So you may want to think, we can actually interact. Let's talk about this kidogo. And the pastor is here. Tumeongea to just a little bit of the church and all that. But I ask you today, is AIC Milimani Youth a church? I'm preaching that AIC Milimani Youth points to ponder, but also points to react, to respond. Is AIC Milimani in church? Of course, I would expect you to say yes. So why are you here if you're not a church? According to what we have gone through. So I am a teacher and that's how I do my review. Is AIC Milimani a church? Youth, actually. I'm concerned about us. Church, you ni badai. Are we a church? Yes. Why? In which way? My brother here.
We are a church that we partake in the body of Christ, we are part of the body of Christ, and we practice the discipline of Christ.
Amen. We are the body of Christ. We are part of the body of Christ, isn't it? Because we are saved, we are sanctified. We are part of the body of Christ universe. One other answer is AIC Milimani a church? Youth. I believe we are. But the second question, we are a church, that's why we are here, isn't it? Does AIC Milimani Youth bear the marks of a true church? I was just going through your calendar of events and your program for the Sunday services. See, I told you we don't have secrets, so I know what's happening the whole year. And I was just looking at it and looking at those marks we have said about the church. And asking myself, so do all these things fit in? Point to ponder again. Are all these programs giving Christ preeminence? At the end of 2017, will we say yes? Christ has been glorified. And of course, I'm very happy about the mission to Chepturu, which we are doing a second time. I have been in this church for, it will be 3 years in June. And I think this is when nimeanza kusikia missions. Now, and God willing, I will be there. Because that is one mark, isn't it? It is in your calendar. So I say, you nearly tick. They are doing missions, yes. But go and take your calendar of events and the true marks of church. Look at those 8 marks. And where we think we are floating down and or we are not very close, may the Lord help us. Because it is very easy to just run a program to excite us, to feel like we belong, the social thing he was saying, but we miss. Is Christ there? Now, unakaa tu hapa all year, unafurahia, you are excited, but at the end of the year, I ask you, so what? What has been happening? How have you grown spiritually? Oh, I went to the retreat, so what? Oh, I went to Chepturo, so what? Did you know? There's a guy who went to Scott together. He was way ahead of us. I will tell you the name later because you know him. Do you know this guy? He went through 4 years of Bible school. And when we went to preach during the 4th year campaigns, we call them that, somewhere, when the guy was preaching like me, then he got saved. So it is very easy for you to go to Chepturu to preach. You have never had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. So it just becomes another program. He runs a very big ministry now, I will tell you. You know, he was never saved. We were given that story when we went to school. 4 years of Bible school with all those theologies, Salvation 1, 2, people called theologies, nini. While he was holding the mic, preaching. Alisema wacha kwanza niombewe niokoke. It is very easy to be in a church program and you are very far from Christ. You have no relationship. It is just a program. So that's what I am asking. Does AIC Milimani Youth bear the marks of a true church? And I believe we do, but let's continue soul searching. And lastly, what is AIC Milimani Youth going to do to be the church that Christ is looking for? And the pastor is here. Points to ponder. So may the Lord help us as we worship together, as we love Him, as we serve Him, that we can simplify the true marks of a church. Thank you for listening. May the Lord bless you.
Amen.
Based on who we are and what we are doing, I'm very, very grateful that we really needed that. Nivo? Yes. We really needed that. And we really we are grateful. God bless you and God add you more. We'll call you more and more into our ministry so that you can come and share the things of Christ to us.